The artificial sweetener found in a lot of your favorite zero-calorie drinks has been making headlines again, and this time it seems more serious than ever. Should we be concerned with the World Health Organization declaring the artificial sweetener aspartame as a potential carcinogen? Let's find out. Aspartame is now an agent in the monographs for carcinogenic hazards to humans under the WHO's cancer research arm, the International Agency for Research on Cancer, or IARC. IARC itself is composed of scientists and experts in fields like toxicology, biochemistry, and epidemiology, which seems fitting for the job, and their work should be taken quite seriously. With aspartame included to their list of carcinogens, understandably, a lot of people are freaking out about all the zero-calorie sodas and sugar-free snacks they've been gobbling down over the years. But if you've been running around the social medias and the internet, you're likely to see two polarizing thoughts regarding this matter. In one corner, you have the anti-chemical or pro-natural crowd strongly hailing this new cancer classification as a big told-you-so with the expertise to back it up. And in the other corner, you have the pro-science crowd, so to say, stating that the scientific evidence is nowhere compelling enough to suggest that aspartame is carcinogenic. Other opinions exist, of course, but you'll see these two butting heads the most. But which side does the truth actually exist? Well, unsurprisingly, the truth sits somewhere in the middle. Let me explain. First, ever since its discovery in the 1960s, aspartame has become one of the most studied food ingredients, and a good chunk of the data does revolve around its association with cancer, including mechanistic, animal, and human evidence. However, as it currently stands, the research indicates what we would call as limited evidence. For human trials, the only studies indicating increased cancer risk or incidences are observational in nature. Now, the benefit of observational studies is that they generally cost less to conduct and allow data to be collected over a longer period of time. However, the drawback is that there are no controlled intervention and findings are at best correlative and at high risk of being muddied by external factors. In this case, an increased hazard ratio with aspartame consumption is largely seen in obesity-related cancer sites, like certain stomach and liver cancers. However, a potential confounding or muddying factor might be the type of individuals that gravitate towards artificially sweetened foods in the first place, which tend to be individuals that are overweight and obese. When studies adjust for body weight or BMI, the hazard ratio for cancer effectively disappears. So evidence in humans is mostly limited in its findings. And same can be said for animal and mechanistic evidence. For animal studies specifically, the only experiments that show increased cancer incidences come from one specific research group. Their findings, however, have not been replicated elsewhere and also have been challenged by other researchers for its potential study design flaws and limitations. Flaws like not using industry standard measurement guidelines and breeding rats in a way that potentially increases their risk for infections. Additionally, we have to consider the doses used. A good sum of their findings point to issues starting at a dose of 2,000 parts per million, which for the average male is equivalent to roughly 40 cans of diet soda per day. Some limited data suggests issues at a lower dose of 400 parts per million, but the outcomes were not too compelling, and that's still about 8 cans of diet soda per day. Again, limited evidence in animals just like everything else, which makes it seem awfully clear that the pro-science crowd got this one right. So how does the actual answer possibly fall somewhere in the middle? Well, that's because having limited evidence is exactly how IARC classified aspartame in their updated monographs. They add aspartame to Group 2B in their classification system. And to be included in Group 2B, an agent simply has to meet one of the following criteria. 1. Have strong mechanistic evidence for cancer. Or 2. Have sufficient animal evidence for cancer. Or 3. Have limited human evidence for cancer. Ding ding. So ultimately, the anti-chemical crowd is technically correct for saying that aspartame is properly classified in IARC's carcinogen monographs. But again, the pro-science crowd is also correct in saying that the data is still quite far from convincing to outright label aspartame as a carcinogen, at least not in the way most normal people would perceive the word at face value. And to be honest, that's really the biggest problem with this whole discussion. Without knowing the additional 2B grouping context, it's no surprise why so many people are overreacting reacting to this news. And it sure doesn't help that the media like to blast these new classifications in our faces every time it happens. But it does kind of make me wonder why IARC and the WHO would use a classification system which on the surface is quite cryptic. No one's first thoughts about something being labeled as a 2B carcinogen is, oh, that's okay, it's just limited human data or strong mechanistic evidence. In fairness, they do have a short descriptor for the group, stating 2B agents as possibly carcinogenic to humans, but that language still isn't exactly comforting. A system that more clearly shows how uncompelling a 2B classification is would be more useful here, at least in my opinion. But hey, at least now you know. At this point, if you're still wondering, let's go ahead and answer the main question. Does this new classification mean we should avoid aspartame? First, if the thought of something being included in a list of possible carcinogens scares you, then sure, you can choose to avoid it. And really, it's not that big of a deal because no one needs aspartame in the first place, and the evidence on its benefits is quite, well, limited. Sure, if you're a habitual sugary soda drinker and want to lose weight, then swapping the drinks out for aspartame-containing diet sodas might help you reduce calorie intake, so long as you do not compensate for it somewhere else. But to ease your cancer concerns a bit further, it's also important to note that in 2022, the WHO themselves conducted a systematic research on artificial sweeteners, which includes aspartame, and found that consuming diet sodas did not increase cancer incidences nor cancer mortality. Additionally, you might want to be informed of other agents included in group 2B, like aloe vera extract and caffeic acid, which is found in coffee, wine, barley, seeds, apples, apricots, and pretty much all plants. Overall, the data is what it is, and that is limited, but the classification is fair, even though, in my opinion, the system can use a revamp. Aspartame, it's whatever, you're not missing out on much if you choose to avoid it. And hey, a little thing called WADA is always an option. If you enjoyed this video, please give it a sweet thumbs up and share it with your diet soda loving friends. Subscribe for more. As always, thank you for watching and don't forget to get your protein. Can't wait for artificial protein, ass protein, delicious.